You're listening to Civic Media. You can tune into any of our live shows on any radio station across the state with the Civic Media app. Find us in your phone's app store and listen anytime, anywhere.
The Patriotic Millionaires also purchase advertising time on various Civic Media stations throughout Wisconsin.
Time for a deep dive into the one issue that matters most in a capitalist democracy, money. This is Maggie and the Millionaires Talking Money, a joint production of the Maggie Dawn Show and the Patriotic Millionaires. Now, here's Maggie Dawn.
Welcome, Wisconsin and beyond. I am Maggie Dawn. This is the Maggie Dawn Show. And as it is the 3 o'clock hour, it means it is Maggie and the Millionaires Talking Money. We are wrapping up an absolutely fabulous week of this segment by focusing on working people. And we're going to pick right up where we left off yesterday with John Driscoll by talking to another successful businessman who believes we should be paying working people better, our good friend, Stephen Prince. Stephen is the vice chair of the Patriotic Millionaires, and he is the true bootstrap story of America. He was born poor in Waycross, Georgia. And in 1993, he founded National Business Products, now known as Card Market Inc., as a gift card and in-store marketing material production company. He basically sells gift cards, and a lot of them. Since selling the majority of his company in 2019, Stephen has focused on his real estate investments, traveling, and his efforts to make the USA what it was like before greed and short-sightedness took over this country. We've got Stephen on today to talk about how he, as a businessman, a capitalist, and himself a millionaire, believes we need to rethink how we structure our economy, and in particular, how we treat and pay working people, the engine of the U.S. economy. Welcome back, Stephen. I'm so happy to have you again. You were with me at the very beginning of the Maggie and the Millionaires segments, and it feels like full circle to have you back again to talk about this very fundamental issue. John Driscoll said that paying employees at least a living wage is an investment in your business, and that it's good for all businesses, whether it's a small startup or a huge corporation. As a businessman, as an investor, as a millionaire, do you agree with that? How do you do that math?
You know, first of all, let me say, I don't know that you really needed me on here today, Maggie. You say it all pretty well yourself, but nonetheless, I'll certainly be happy to weigh in. To me, it's hard to imagine that people who are business people don't understand the fact that paying your employees and all employees at least a living wage, if not an exceptional wage, is not the best way to achieve success with your business. It's ludicrous to think that otherwise. I don't know many companies, and there certainly are some, I mean, and I could name some of them that underpay their employees and they still do very well. But to me, you know, the simplest calculation for considering this point is that we are unequivocally, and everyone knows anything about economics realizes that the United States economy is a consumer driven country. 66%, full two thirds of our whole economic flow is driven by consumers. And yet we don't realize that putting money in their pockets is the best way to drive our economy. Instead, we, for some delirious reason, decide that we as owners or we as executives in corporations, we need to keep it all to ourselves. The fallacy for that is that those of us that have plenty of money don't spend a lot of money, certainly not on consumable items. We already have a house, many times several. We already have cars, and they all have brand new tires on them. We have more clothes than we know what to wear. I mean, we just don't consume because we have everything we want. Yet we don't want to pay the people who work for us a wage that allows them to cover the essentials of life, shelter, clothing, healthcare, those kinds of things, but then go buy other things that, like the rest of us in America, we really don't need, but they have a right to have excess the same way that the rest of us do. To me, again, it's ludicrous that we even have to have this conversation. paying the people that you know, the dock strikers work, right? That just, you know, put a short-term yes. stop today. I mean, those guys are already making pretty good money, but the people in their industry are making tremendous amounts of money. They just don't want to share it. And to me, it's short-sighted. It's ill-founded. And I think that sooner or later, I'd like to think that sooner or later we'll figure this out, but we're not, because greed is a universal attribute to mankind. And if we get in the position where we can activate our greed attribute, we will, or most people do. But John Driscoll is certainly a great example of someone who not only doesn't activate that greed attribute, but he's proven that not doing so is a good business move. Look at the success he's experienced. So to me, to not recognize the fact that paying your employees a living wage, a thriving wage, it makes all the sense in the world. It's good business.
Folks, that's Stephen Prince, my special guest for this episode of Maggie and the Millionaires Talking Money. To summarize what you said, rich people are not the engine of this country's democracy or capitalistic economy, because rich people already have everything that they need. They've already bought it, so they are not the consumers. The middle class working people are consumers and thus are the engine of our economy. And John, I've got to ask you, because this comes up all the time, it seems like some sort of collective hallucination has taken hold. Even when I'm talking to folks that tend to vote Democratic, I hear this concern about paying people a dignity wage, right? Enough, not just to live, but to thrive. They seem to, oh my gosh, businesses are going to collapse. What do you pinpoint as the cause of this collective misunderstanding? Is it, frankly, our culture's embracing and lionization of greed? Does this go back to, you know, greed is good in the movie Wall Street? Is it that basic that we've made greed like a value instead of something that should be discouraged and that our tax code should not be promoting?
Well, it really isn't complex. We human beings like to think that we're much more sophisticated and universally aware than we really are. Greed is a really deep dive human attribute, and we'll call it anything but that. But the way that corporations are running themselves today, the way Wall Street is running themselves today, you know, and I was thinking about this when we were talking about paying people salary. Look at Wall Street as a perfect example, in the banking industry in New York and all the big banks that are there. You know, these young people come out of college and they start at salaries of $250,000. And if they're there another year, then the chances are they're going to last a little while because they burn out so soon, or they don't burn out at all. And then they start climbing precipitously, $500,000 a year, $750,000 a year. Before you know it, they're making $1 or $2 million a year. Now, it's the same executives that run those companies, whether it's Goldman Sachs or Morgan Stanley or whoever it is. These are the same guys that will go out and tell some of their corporations that they've invested in Kansas City or Atlanta, Georgia, wherever they've invested in, and say, you've got to cut salaries. You've got to cut salaries. That's the only way you're going to get to profitability. Well, they don't do it. I mean, look what they're doing with their own employees. They're paying their own employees these crazy salaries to stay on board. So they're contradicting their own concept, yet they tell their corporation clients or the companies that they've invested in. It's just a fallacy. Why do we do it? It's an easy, I mean, it's like getting the second dessert. You don't need that second dessert, but it's there. So yeah, I'll have another slice of pie and give me some extra ice cream on there. It's just a natural human attribute. We are greedy, selfish creatures. And I don't know what, if there is a repair. The only thing that repairs it is legislation. That's the only way we can fix it. You're not going to cajole people into doing the right thing. You have to make them do the right thing. And that's legislation.
That is Stephen Prince, himself a millionaire, a rich guy, and a self-made one at that. He is my special guest on this episode of Maggie and the Millionaires Talking Money. You have been highly successful in business. You have overseen tens of thousands of employees over the course of your career. How did you decide how to pay and how much to pay your employees?
It's just always been kind of an innate sense of mine that treating everyone the way that you would want to be treated if you were in their position, the old golden rule is, it's a valid approach to life. And when our company was coming up, we made money early on. We were profitable the first year we were in business. As we grew and then as we got in the gift card business, it was a very lucrative business. And I wanted to treat my employees with the respect that I thought that they deserved. I'm sad to admit that since I left, some of those philosophies have changed. I'm still on the board and I still have arguments from time to time with the rest of our board about that. We were having a recent discussion about profitability and, you know, trying to satisfy our bank's desires to have certain levels of margin. And the first thing that some of the people on the board said, we need to cut benefits. We need to cut insurance compensation. Let's make them pay more than insurance. I said, guys, we are not doing that. That is not who we are. We are not going to ride to success by taking money out of the pockets of our employees. If we can't figure out a way to make this thing work the way we want it to work by just being better business people, as opposed to having to cut benefits and cut salaries to our employees, then we need to shut it down. That's not a good business. And I don't want to participate in a company like that. So it's sad, but it's what a lot of company executives do over and over and over again.
I'm putting that on a t-shirt, Stephen. If you cannot pay your employees a respectable, dignified salary with the benefits that accord to a thriving middle class, it ain't a good business model, and we got to shut it down. Folks, we're going to come back with Stephen Prince. We're going to dig into the conversations you had with congresspeople and other CEOs. What is blocking us from solving this problem, the thing that's holding our country back from even more explosive economic growth, so that we all can share in this, the greatest country on the planet, these United States of
America.
In
the history of mankind.
That's right, sir. I love it. Maggie and the Millionaires Talking Money here on the Civic Media Radio Network. We'll be back with all of you in just a moment after these brief messages. Keep it locked.
Time for a deep dive into the one issue that matters most in a capitalist democracy, money. This is Maggie and the Millionaires Talking Money, a joint production of the Maggie Dawn Show and the Patriotic Millionaires. Now, here's Maggie Dawn.
Welcome back, everybody. Thanks for listening today to today's episode of Maggie and the Millionaires Talking Money. Really excited to be joined by my very special guest, Stephen Prince, the vice chair of the Patriotic Millionaires, a self-made millionaire himself, and a man that believes that paying workers a fair and dignified wage is central to any business's success. Stephen, you know a lot of other CEOs and rich folks. You live in Georgia. You're from there. I gotta imagine that you hear all sorts of rationalizations and pushback to this basic idea. Why, you know, what do you say to your business owner buddies who say that you're crazy and that we need to keep the minimum wage where it is, which was set back in, I think, 2006 or seven. It hasn't moved in nearly 20 years.
Well, you know, most everybody down here that knows me knows where I come from. They know how I feel about these things. But the other thing is telling for someone, even a CEO of a company with 50 or 500 or 5,000 employees, they will seldom, I don't think I've ever heard anybody say that they think that $7.25 is a fair wage. What they will say is that nobody gets paid $7.25 an hour, which I think is ludicrous. That's not true. I mean, I think there are 20 states right now that are still $7.25 is the minimum wage, which is less than $15,000 a year. Yeah. Now, who anywhere in the United States of America can live on $15,000 a year, especially given the fact they're even going to pay some taxes on that, maybe with earned income tax credit, they may get a little bit of it back. But I want to veer off for just a second over what we pay people and talk about what people get to keep. Yes. I think one of the biggest issues that I'm frustrated with right now, I'm about 80% through a book that's going to wind up having a remarkable impact on the way that I view these issues. And it's called The Wolf on K Street. Mm-hmm. And I was never aware of the history of how we got to where we are now. But it started in the early 70s, post-Nixon, when lobbyists and attorneys came to realize that they could have a huge impact on a federal and a state level in determining how much taxes corporations and individuals paid. Now, none of these attorneys or none of these lobbyists were concerned about the working class. They were only worried about the wealthy people, the business owners, the CEOs, and the upper level executives of these corporations. So they have slowly, methodically, and meticulously adjusted tax law in the last 50 years to where the working class right now typically pay a higher tax rate than the CEO of the corporation. And it's just not right. So what I'm saying is that even if you pay these people, you raise the minimum wage from $7.25 to, let's say, to $15 an hour, and it really probably should be $20 an hour, they still won't live. The way their money is treated will not be the same. Another example that I will give you is inheritances. Well, yeah, up until about 10 or 12 years ago, the maximum amount that you could protect if you left a large stash of cash for your kids was $650,000 per person. Today, it's over $11 million per person. So a mother and a father can leave $22 million to the children. And I had a big argument recently with another wealthy friend of mine about that very issue, because he's going to leave that much or more to his children. And he says, well, it's not right. I've already paid the taxes on it. And I said, yes, that's true. You did pay taxes on it, but your children didn't pay any taxes on it. And when they get that check for $7, $10, $15 million per child, any way you want to cut it, it's income. Yeah. And if it's income, it should be taxed as income. So what they've learned to do is just you wrap another term around it. You call it another word so you get to treat it differently. So the imbalance that's taking place in America right now is really hidden in tax law. But back to the point that you asked about, we need to raise minimum wage, but we don't need to raise it to a set level. It needs to be set on the minimum amount of money that it takes for someone to live, which is about $40,000 a year for an individual. That needs to be the number, and they shouldn't have to pay any taxes until they get above that level. So if they make $40,000 a year, they pay zero taxes, so they get to keep it all to live on. It's a multi-level correction that we need to go through, but I think that's the tack we have to take.
And that is exactly what was proposed just last week in the American Sustainability Act, introduced by Representative Summer Lee of the 12th District of Pennsylvania, a meaningful sustainability wage that is indexed to inflation and a tax exemption for the cost of living. Right. Duh is what I say to this. Like, why should working people who are barely getting by pay any income tax? It just doesn't make any sense. Why should wealth, capital gains, be taxed differently and at a lower rate than work? it's the same sort of earning, right? Why should that income to those that are inherited not get taxed just like a working person's income? It is all of a whole. I like to say, Stephen, if you want to talk about childcare policy, if you want to talk about strengthening our borders, you're talking about tax policy and making it more fair to working people in this country. My special guest this half hour, Stephen Prince, Vice President of the Patriotic Millionaires, a bootstrap millionaire himself, earned it all on his own ingenuity and business acumen, which included paying his workers a fair wage. And folks, if you're interested in this history of tax policy that Stephen is referring to, that's going to be discussed in his new book once he gets it done, The Wolf on K Street, I'm going to be joined next Friday for an entire hour by historian Heather Cox Richardson. And all we're going to be talking about is the history of tax policy in this country. Stephen, you may find that pretty interesting yourself. I want to just ask you this baseline question, because this is how it's always framed by the right. We've got about a minute left. The right always claims that taxing, quote, job creators like yourself will hurt the economy. Fact or fiction?
That's ridiculous. I mean, to me, it's laughable. It's so self-serving that it bears no validity as far as I'm concerned, because by saying that is you don't want to pay any taxes. I get that. You don't want to pay any taxes. But I tell all my wealthy friends, if we paid our people more, they lived a better life, we still wouldn't give up any of the lifestyle that we have. We'd still have our multiple homes. We'd still have multiple cars, and we'd have our private jets. It would not change our lifestyle. But it would change the lifestyle of the people that work for us. They're not mutually exclusive goals. They really aren't. They're not fighting one another. We can do both.
We've got to leave it there. That's Stephen Prince, Vice Chair of the Patriotic Millionaires, my friend and now yours. We'll be back with more on the Civic Media Radio Network.
You're listening to Civic Media. Find the latest news, information, and archives of all your favorite shows on the Civic Media website, civicmedia.us.
Always want to hear if you disagree. We'll talk about it. I'm Maggie Dawn. You're listening to The Maggie Dawn Show here on the Civic Media Radio Network. Thanks for listening all week, folks. And if you're still wondering, especially about your state legislative assembly and Senate races, do not fear. Civic Media is here. We are always here to help you. And we've got an incredibly valuable, detailed look, take at all of the legislative races, all 115 of them happening this year in the Wisconsin State Legislature. And things have changed. We've got new maps. For the first time in well over a decade, we have fairer maps. And finally, people will have some meaningful choices in selecting their state assembly people and senators. If you want to check out Civic Media's breakdown of all 115 Senate and assembly races, just go to civicmedia.us to learn more. And of course, as we go into this weekend, folks, you may be spending time with your loved ones, and you may be thinking of those people that are hurting up and down the eastern seaboard as a result of Hurricane Ellen. If you want to help them out, go to civicmedia.us/help. We've got links there to the American Red Cross and Samaritan's Purse. We're not touching the money. We're not taking any of it. It's just to help you get to a couple of the aid organizations on the ground, helping people in North Carolina and other states that are victims of this biblical natural disaster, because climate change is a real thing, despite what Ron Johnson, Donald Trump, and J.D. Vance may say. Before we get to local and overlooked, wanted to take a caller. Billy, what do you have to say this afternoon?
Hey, Maggie, can you hear me?
I can talk real loud if you can,
hey,
Billy.
Maggie, I'm sorry, can you hear me?
Yep, that's better. Go ahead, sir.
Yeah, I'm loving your series on economics as much as I can catch it, and the discussion of kind of how the correlation between income and or wealth and the amount of taxes you pay should be. And I don't know if such a study exists, but I would really be interested to know not just the direction, but some of the details of the correlation between an individual's level of wealth and the amount, the value of the personal and professional benefit they derive from, you know, public infrastructure, et cetera. Like, you know, if I can't afford a car, I'm not getting the same level of benefit from use of the roads as someone who can. And if I own a McDonald's franchise, you know, I'm benefiting from, you know, my customers being able to get to my business, et cetera, et cetera. So I just really love to understand in numbers what the correlation is between the wealth of a person and the public and professional good they derive from those public services that are out there that we all pay for as taxpayers.
Thanks so much, Billy. I love this question, right? Because the wealthiest among us, and certainly the most consistently wealthy and profitable corporations, are wealth extractive, not just because they dodge their fair share of taxes, but because they benefit from the infrastructural supports. I don't care what we're talking about, what element of infrastructure that our middle class tax dollars afford, whether it's Jeff Bezos moving his packages on the roads that we pay for, right? Or whether it's a corporation hiring people, skilled workers that have been trained and educated in our public education systems, or in a private school paid for by middle class tax dollars through a voucher or choice program. All of this matters. And I can guarantee you this, Billy, whatever, and I will try to find an analysis of that, but the use, the exploitation of one single taxpayer dollar, in other words, how much benefit a single taxpayer dollar provides to each and every one of us in the middle class versus the richest, I bet that proportion is shocking. In other words, of every tax dollar invested in these sorts of programs that allow the wealthiest to remain the wealthiest and acquire even more wealth, they are getting a much larger benefit of every tax dollar than regular middle class folks are. Because, you know, I don't own a fleet of jet or a penis rocket to the sky. And with that, I think it's time for a little political relief. I am so happy it is Friday because we get to talk about what's good, local, and overlooked in Wisconsin. Today, I've got one of my other fabulous female friends in broadcasting. Teri Barr is on a film set. She is on site. So congrats, Teri. Can't wait to talk about that. But I'm joined with my very good friend, Kathryn Lake. Thanks for making time, Kathryn.
Hi, Mags. Happy to be here.
Tell us what's good, local, and overlooked in Wisconsin today.
Okay, well, as far as I know, the way this goes is I tell you some place that's a little overlooked, but I don't know if I have a place that's utterly overlooked because everybody in Wisconsin knows about all the great places in Wisconsin. We're a very prideful state, I have learned over the last 30-plus years I've been around here. And so for me, it's fall colors right now. I am going to drag my kid, my 14-year-old daughter, kicking and screaming, into the car to go look at the fall colors. And it's really the best way to do it by car. And for me, it's driving straight west. My sister came to visit me in Madison when I first got back last summer/fall. And she said, I want to see the Mississippi. I'm like, okay, well, you know, that doesn't come through here. So we're going to have to get in the car. And we drove over to La Crosse. And it's 2.25 hours, rather, from Madison. Not too far. Probably too far and unnecessary for Milwaukee. If you want to see some fall colors, you don't have to go all the way across to La Crosse. Go north, Mequon, Sheboygan, Door County. Gorgeous.
And Port Washington, yes, Milwaukee. Yes.
Port Washington, I was just going to talk about that, yes. So in La Crosse, of course, the riverboats depart from Riverside Park there. They've got this international friendship garden that features landscape styles from all around the world, which is, I think, why I'm going to choose to go there with my daughter, because just bought a house, really need to figure out my landscape style. I don't have one in this house just yet, and everybody around me does, so I think I'm going to try to hit that. They also are fest happy in La Crosse, like a lot of places in Wisconsin. We love our fests. We're going to make a festival out of whatever you got all year long. So they've got, of course, an Oktoberfest in La Crosse, a River Fest, and on the 16th, Adventure Festival begins there. It's at the Rivoli Theater, which is a beautiful theater. It's Films and Storytelling Adventure Festival. Starts on the 16th. I think it's a five-day fest there in La Crosse.
Wow.
So I could recommend that. If you don't want to go too far from Madison, which is a perfectly great place to see the fall colors as well, but if you want to go a little less distance, maybe an hour 45 to Prairie du Chien, of course, the orangutan went there recently to make hay. But Prairie du Chien is actually a really beautiful place. They sport a really nice look at the Mississippi at the River Sculpture Park there. And they have the Casino Queen Marquette across the river in Iowa. You can use a few bucks there. Spook Cave Campground, which sounds awesome for kids. Prairie Funland, another place for great for kids. And a fantastic educational thing to do with your kids. And I want to bring Bailey there, my daughter, to spend some time at Effigy Mounds National Monument. Effigy Mounds preserves more than, get this, 200 prehistoric mounds built by pre-Columbian mound builder cultures. So that would be something really spectacular to get a look at, all surrounded, of course, by the fall colors. And
yes,
if you want to head up north to Door County, Washington Island, that's the spot, Schoolhouse Beach. I want to go here. I have not been there yet, but I've been to Door County, and it is, of course, fall color extravaganza. But this Schoolhouse Beach is so beautiful and so important that taking its rocks is actually against the law. It's a perfect spot for people who don't want to get sand in their bathing suits, but these rocks, they're about palm size, some smaller. There's only four other similar sandless beaches in the world. The shore, Schoolhouse Beach, is named for a one-room wooden schoolhouse that used to be there. Some people probably already know this. It's been replaced by a picnic table and a barbecue area. But these small rocks have been glacier polished over thousands of years, and they're little geological treasures. So, again, souvenir hunters have carried off a lot of the rocks now, so now there's a big fine for taking even one. So
Kathryn, let me just jump in real quick. So first of all, yes, everybody's got to put Schoolhouse Beach on Washington Island on your Wisconsin bucket list. It is not to be missed. And no matter what, if you get there on a sunny day, even if it's in the fall or a different time of year, what's wonderful about these stones is that they heat up. And so you basically get like a hot stone massage if you just lay down on these rocks. Now, if you do happen to get a little seasick, be sure you take your Dramamine before you get on the ferry to go from the tip of the point of the Door Peninsula to Washington Island. It can be a wee bit choppy out there. They used to call it Death's Door. It was quite a navigation challenge for many ships because there were, again, these different archaeological outcroppings. I shouldn't say archaeological, but geological from the glacial period. And I have a little bit of a funny story for you, Kathryn, about Fall Fest.
Tell me.
In Door County, of course. And folks, if you've been listening to the Local and Overlooked segment for a while, I have a little behind the curtains for you. I never know what my very special guests are going to talk about, which offers an opportunity for me to often embarrass myself with stories from the past. And I have one. One of my best friends from college was a big Fall Fest fan. And I frequently, in college, went up there with her. And we were fortunate enough to stay on her family's small boat, which they docked for the summer up in Egg Harbor. And here's the funny part. You know, being in college, we may have had an irresponsible number of adult beverages celebrating the fall colors in the Door Peninsula and went and, of course, racked out on the boat. Her dad, who was also in town, thought it would be just hilarious to make sure that we were up and at 'em at sunrise. And so he snuck onto the boat, of course, his boat, and put in Jimi Hendrix, the Jimi Hendrix Experience at maximum blast on the boat's stereo speakers to wake us up. And he started with Jimi Hendrix playing the national anthem at Woodstock.
Of course.
So I have lots of fun memories of Fall Fest up in the Door Peninsula.
Now, Door County is just, it's a rare place in this entire country on earth, I even might gather. I just think Door County is spectacular. It just is. Now, have you ever been to the Nelson's Hall and Bitters Club?
No, but I'm intrigued already.
Oh, it's the oldest continuously operating tavern in Wisconsin at the tip of the Door County Peninsula. The owner used a clever loophole to get patrons drunk right through prohibition. So let me say it again. It's the oldest continuously operating tavern, has never stopped all the way through prohibition. So the owner, this Dane named Tom Nelson, he founded the Nelson Hall as a dance hall, but heard that alcohol can be purchased and dispersed and dispensed for medicinal reasons. He doesn't have a doctor. He's not a doctor. He doesn't have access to green alcohol, which they were using a lot for depression and anxiety. I'll take care of it. I take a pill for that now. So Nelson applied for and received a pharmacist's license, and he used bitters, which apparently contain 45% alcohol, 90 proof.
Yes, 90 proof.
Parlance. Yes, right. So he prescribed shots of Angostura bitters to patrons, thus retaining his clientele and saving his business during the prohibition time. Oh, here's the kicker.
Wonderful.
He brought it to the, yeah, he brought it. You have to go probably, right? He brought it to court. You love this. He gave it to the judge, and the judge said, yeah, that doesn't taste good. That has to be medicine. Keep doing it.
A gentleman and a scholar, Mr. Nelson. Thanks so much, Kathryn Lake, my female fabulous friend in broadcasting. You have a wonderful weekend. Big hug to Bailey. Enjoy your fall color drive. Folks, we're going to come back here on the Maggie Dawn Show on the Civic Media Radio Network. There's a brand new ad for Kamala Harris that I think you're going to want to take a listen to. Issued by one of the country's great national treasure musical recording artists. That's coming up next. Don't miss it. Here on the Civic Media Radio Network. Like it's going to be beautiful in most places in the state, at least this afternoon and most of tomorrow. Enjoy it, friends. I hope you get out there to enjoy some of those fall colors. My thanks to Kathryn Lake from WMDX for joining me for a special substitute special edition of What's Good Local and Overlooked in Wisconsin. You can find that segment here every Friday in the 3:30 block. But we're at the end of this week's episodes of Maggie and the Millionaires. We're at the end of the Maggie Dawn Show. And I thought it only fitting to not just talk about these polling numbers from the latest Marquette University poll, but point out first that Senate race between Tammy Baldwin and Eric Hovde is much closer than I think the 6 points that the most recent MU Law School poll showed. Other polling is showing a near dead heat, and we just got word over the last 24 hours that conservatives are piling in tens of millions of dollars and will be outspending Democrats and Baldwin-aligned PACs by millions between now and Election Day. This is a must-win Senate race for Republicans. The airwaves are going to be blanketed. So, folks, if you want to get involved, you can do that first and foremost by making sure that you are registered to vote, making a voting plan, and telling your friends and family about the issues that matter most and where these candidates stand. You can find out where you can get registered to vote, check your registration status, confirm your polling place, and help your friends and family do the same at myvote.wi.gov. That's myvote.wi.gov. Want to get that website correct. It matters. It matters a lot. Check out all those things. And yesterday, I mentioned a couple of websites that are really helpful for fact checking. And I wanted to share those again today because I think almost more than anything, getting a good independent approach to analyze what the candidate's claims are, what their records are, is so extraordinarily important. So I wanted to take a minute before we close out the show this afternoon to share those websites with you again. There's two. The first one is called usafacts.org. That's usafacts.org. The second one is mediabiasfactcheck.com. That's mediabiasfactcheck.com. Check those out. They help fact check candidates and debates. They help you understand how candidates represent their records, and they help you assess the bias of various media outlets. So I highly recommend both ensuring that you've got a voting plan and spending some time looking at the candidates to make sure that they align with your values and what's most important to you. But speaking about what's most important to you, I think it's fairly indisputable that Wisconsinites and Americans believe in what I'm going to call middle-class values. Work hard, you get ahead. And right now, I think most of us out there, most of you feel like, hey, I'm working hard and I might not be getting ahead. And that feeling, right, that tension, that disappointment, I think is something that the recording artist Bruce Springsteen has represented so incredibly well in his body of work over four decades in the entertainment business. He's the boss, right? Like, that is the deal. So as we close out this week's shows, I wanted to end with a new spot that was just released last night in support of Kamala Harris. This is Bruce Springsteen telling you all why he's endorsing Kamala Harris and what this election means.
Hi, I'm Bruce Springsteen. Friends, fans, and the press have asked me who I'm supporting in this most important of elections. And with full knowledge that my opinions no more or less important than those of any of my fellow citizens, here's my answer. I'm supporting Kamala Harris for president and Tim Walz for vice president and opposing Donald Trump and J.D. Vance. Here's why. We are shortly coming upon one of the most consequential elections in our nation's history. Perhaps not since the Civil War has this great country felt as politically, spiritually, and emotionally divided as it does then at this moment. It doesn't have to be this way. The common values, the shared stories that make us a great and united nation are waiting to be rediscovered and retold once again. Now that will take time. Hard work, intelligence, faith, and women and men with the national good guiding their hearts. America's the most powerful nation on earth, not just because of her overwhelming military strength or economic power, but because of what she stands for, what she means, what she believes in. Freedom, social justice, equal opportunity, the right to be and love who you want. These are the things that make America great. Donald Trump is the most dangerous candidate for president in my lifetime. His disdain for the sanctity of our Constitution, the sanctity of democracy, the sanctity of the rule of law, and the sanctity of the peaceful transfer of power should disqualify him from the office of president ever again. He doesn't understand the meaning of this country, its history, or what it means to be deeply American. On the other hand, Kamala Harris and Tim Walz are committed to a vision of this country that respects and includes everyone, regardless of class, religion, race, your political point of view, or sexual identity.
And Mr. Springsteen continues. We're going to leave it there, folks. Have a blessed weekend. Remember, I'll stand up for you. I hope you stand up for me. But it is always better when we stand together for democracy. Dom Savia is up next here on the Civic Media Radio Network.
The national news cycle never stops, but it can be hard to find news about your local community. Civic Media is dedicated to providing quality local and state news coverage across Wisconsin. With the Civic Media app, you can get notifications about local stories that matter to you and your community. Find the free Civic Media app in your phone's app store and choose notifications from the menu to tell us what kind of news you want to hear about.